In his short 12-year career, Art Bolin achieved 4 British number ones, 3 number one LPs, with record sales topping 60,000 a day. He lived the iconic rock and roll dream, constantly evolving on the journey from teenage mod pinup to rock god, idol to millions.
I'm your toy, your 20th century boy. Ha!
Rock and roll's a bitch. I mean, you got to come on, like a bitch. I mean, you can't be real. I mean, I'm not the boy next door, you know. I never was. That's why I'm successful. I don't want to be the boy next door, and they don't want me to be the boy next door. So, in fact, on that stage, I'm at liberty. I'm in a realm of fantasy. I can do whatever I want to do and get away with it.
Mark has left a canon of work that any 29-year-old would be very proud of.
If you play a T-Rex record now, they're as vibey as ever. They celebrate life, they celebrate sexuality, they celebrate fun.
He was Elvis, he was Cliff, he was Jimi Hendrix. He was the lot rolled into this strange new package.
Mark Bolin was born Mark Feld on September 30th, 1947, to parents Phyllis and Sid. The family home was in North London, opposite Stoke Newington Common, where he and brother Harry often played.
My mum and dad, they didn't have a lot of money. My mum worked in the market in Berwick Street. My dad was a lorry driver in our younger years. But nothing was too much for them. If they knew we wanted something, we'd have to wait. But they always managed to come up with the goods. We were two different personalities. He was much smaller, very fast, very lively, always running around, where I was the slower one. The first fantasy he had when he was, must have been about five then, was the Mighty Joe Young film. He would adopt a frontman. It's like Clark Kent and Superman. And his first one was Mighty Joe Young. He was the big gorilla and nobody could beat him. And through the years, until he realised that you couldn't be a gorilla all your life, it was always a front. And Mark Bolin was a front. I think it was when he was 11. My mum bought him a guitar off the back of a newspaper. He had no professional tuition. He just strummed away to it till he taught himself how to play a guitar.
I think what I remember mostly about the visual aspect of rock and roll is A Girl Can't Help It, seeing that film, which I remember seeing Eddie Cochran, the way he held his guitar and moved, looked good, you know? Little Richard put his foot on the piano, and that felt very outrageous. I think Elvis was a man, because he really used to wiggle his bum, you know? He used to get down on that. That influenced me incredibly, I think. I always used to get being very impressed with the fact that he always had a guitar there. I mean, that to me was the ultimate showman thing. Just sort of pushed it behind his back and threw it around. And, of course, the hair was very much part of a rock show, I think. Little Richard had about a 7-inch quiff, didn't he? And Elvis, was always so greased up and always had, like, a hole in the front of his quiff that used to blow my mind, you know? Ain't no cure for the summertime.
One person who knew Mark well during his formative teenage years was school friend Richard Young, who sat at the next desk to Mark for 4 years.
I first met Mark Feld. I was age 11. We were put into the same classroom and we sat together. We all hanged around Stamford Hill outside this amusement arcade, and all the guys had their GS Vespas. And he was the individualist. He was the face. He was the catalyst of this whole new era that was coming through of guys trying to be very fashionable. There was something very mystical about him, and I picked up on it very, very quickly from sitting next to him in school. On any given Friday, if he didn't fancy going to play games, he would say to me, "Come on, Richard, just get out of here." I said, "Okay." We used to play truant. We used to go down to the West End to Berwick Street Market, where his mum had her vegetable store. My dad had his ladies' hosiery store. And we would catch money off them and go down to Old Compton Street. And there was this wonderful shop there called Sportique. We used to go in there, and if we didn't nick the stuff, we were buying it. I mean, Mark was the only person I know that when I came to school, age 11, 12, 13, he'd be wearing handmade suits, you know, from tailors up from the East End.
And it was Mark's taste in clothes, and not the music that was soon to dominate his life, that gave the 15-year-old mod his first taste of fame when a 60s lifestyle magazine paid a visit to Stoke Newington.
Mark ended up in Town magazine in, I think it was September 1962. It was an issue devoted to youth, precociously young, but immaculately dressed in, you know, top mod kind of gear. Everything carefully, you know, the exact amount of buttons, the button-down shirt, the vents at the back. I mean, whatever it took to make him look different.
Mark Fell, to me, was the foundation of the person that I became, and the things that influence me now all stemmed back from that period of that valuable 4 years I spent with Mark Feld in school.
He wasn't interested in school, and in the end, the school agreed with him and they just let him go his own way.
I left school at 14, I was expelled.
Why were you expelled?
Well, it was very amicable. I just didn't think they were teaching me the things I wanted to know, so I didn't go too much in the end. Played truant all the time.
He did a couple of odd job things. He worked in the Wimpy Bar, I think, and a clothes shop. But in between, most of the time, he just carried on with his aim of getting into the music business at some time.
Mark's hanging out with people who might be able to help him with his dream of getting to the top soon paid off when he met the teenaged presenter of TV's popular The 5 O'Clock Club.
I met Mark Feld when I was about 15 at a party. He came back to my place, and I just rented my first apartment in those days. Everybody came to the flat because, one, I was young, and two, it's a place to crash out. He got quite comfortable in this place, obviously so. And like most people, just moved in without asking, and never anything as vulgar as rent. He was obsessed by being famous. He, for hours and hours and hours, would be sitting cross-legged on the floor playing his little guitar and singing to himself. It occurred to me one day, because I was doing this little pop show thing called 5 O'Clock Club, that maybe I could get him on the show. And then I thought, well, if I can get him on the show, then I could be, we should sign a contract, I'll be his manager. He said, will you be my manager and get me on the show? And then we went to Regent Sound in Denmark Street, and he picked a song called Blowing in the Wind, which was Bob Dylan's song.
Mark did style himself as a Dylan-style folky for a while. Also, it was quite easy to do. If you knew three chords, you could bash out a folk song. You listen to those multiple takes of Blowing in the Wind, and it's pretty grim. He hadn't really found, at all, he hadn't found his true voice yet.
When record companies passed on Blowing in the Wind, Mark moved on in search of new inspiration and met the more worldly-wise American actor Riggs O'Hara. Together, they went to Paris for a few days, an experience that so impressed Mark that it later became an integral part of the Mark Bolan myth.
Yeah, I used to know a guy in Paris who, in fact, was... he would be called a black magician, I suppose, but he wasn't. He's just a very learned man. He was into numerology and Egyptian magic. And I learned... he could levitate, you know, go off the floor. He really could do it.
Can I? No.
Only when I'm drunk.
Hanging out with the right people finally led to Mark getting an offer from Decca Records in 1965. And memories of the trip to Paris formed the inspiration to his very first single, The Wizard. The record also saw Mark Feld rename himself as Mark Bolan, a key step in the reinvention of the 18-year-old Londoner into a rock legend. Shadows follow. Despite an early appearance on TV pop show Ready, Steady, Go, the Wizard single flopped, and Mark decided on a new approach. He sought out and joined manager Simon Napier Bell's roster of artists, who included the Yardbirds with Eric Clapton and Jimmy Page, and a new group, John's Children.
They lacked songs, and they really, in a way, they almost lacked a frontman as well, so he decided to install Bolan in John's Children as a kind of a Pete Townshend figure, the one with the brains and the songs as well.
And I wanted a folk poet, rock and roll, good-looking superstar, boogie-woogie, schmuck, you know, and I was around. So, hey, you know, it's one of those. I mean, you know, I could have been anyone. Uh-huh. But all that happened is that I wrote Desdemona, which is a dynamite song.
one day he said, I'm going to go and introduce you to this guy and see what you think. So he drove me over, dropped me off there and banged on the door, and there's Mark opened it, and his parents were out, gone to work. And he said, oh, hi, mate, come in, you know. He sat down and started playing some songs, put on some Bob Dylan, invited me to have some mushrooms on toast, told me the books that he was reading and stuff, and we just sat down there for the afternoon, and I didn't know really what to make of him. He was just this quiet little guy who wrote strange songs.
I don't think I was ever formally introduced to Mark. I don't think anybody at any time said to me personally.
But do you remember the time that we first got him down to our club and handed him an electric guitar? He's never played electric guitar before, ever.
It was fun.
And we had a little rehearsal and then left him there. And it was about 2 hours. He was just playing, making this noise on this huge sound.
It was literally a case of, here's the lead. And he put it into this stodgy SG, this thing. And suddenly this incredible bass splurge came out at an enormous volume. Even by our standards.
Oh my God, he was out of his mind playing this electric stuff.
Mark had a very percussive way of playing. When he played an acoustic, for example, it was quite percussive. I remember when we first did Desdemona, he said it's kind of got a jailhouse rock feel. I thought, okay, you know, that sort of thing. But this noise came out, and there is no way it could have ticked like jailhouse rock.
In April 1967, John's children supported The Who on a German tour.
After a few numbers, you know, I'd just leap into the audience. Mark would be sort of having feedback from his guitar and smashing chains on the stage. John would be rolling around and I'd have a fight with him. And we'd have blood capsules and, you know, rip all our clothes off. And then, of course, you know, riots eventually did ensue.
But the riots were the last straw for The Who's management, and John's children were thrown off the German tour.
Do you remember on the way back from Germany, we stopped off in Luxembourg?
Yeah, well, the car broke down, you
know. Well, no, we went and saw Ravi Shankar.
Yeah.
I remember Mark was really just sitting right there watching this, thinking,
absolutely,
you know.
Absolutely. There he was on the carpet with the Joss sticks. So maybe he thought, well, actually, this is the route I need to go for a while.
Mark's last gig with John's children was at the legendary 60s happening, the 14-hour Technicolor Dream, held at Alexander Palace in North London, a true 60s experience. Newly found footage of the event shows Mark with the band.
It's very hallucinogenic.
Hang on.
People might have been taking drugs. Is that?
Yep.
Oh, my God.
And there's your good self.
Yeah.
That's you again. That must be Mark.
This was the last gig that we did, wasn't it?
With Mark. I mean, there was absolutely no plan to play anything. It was just, okay, right, well, let's go on stage. It had gone by then. But I think that's probably why Mark disappeared, you know. He'd go away and think, well, I don't want to be involved in that. I need to get a couple of songs together, or I've got some verses in my head, or something. I think he was very focused on where he was going and what he wanted to do. Because he was, you know, he wrote songs, and he liked writing songs, and he was into that. Much more serious than us.
After 3 or 4 months in John's Children, Bolan had enough of submerging himself and his personality in the band. Also, he realised what was happening at the time. There was a whole new movement growing on the underground where you could kind of take control yourself a little bit, a whole new network of clubs and that. So he decided he was going to then go back to his folk kind of roots with his beaten-up acoustic guitar, advertise for a like-minded kind of hippie soul, and who came in the form of Steve Took. And within a few weeks, they worked up this set of very, very voguish, whimsical, hippie kind of songs, reveling in amateurism in a way, but quite beautiful too.
Again, Mark had changed style from the rock theatrics of John's children to a more intellectual folk music for the hippies. And for the name of the group, he remembered a line from one of the science fiction books he'd read as a boy, and Tyrannosaurus Rex was born. Mark had finally discovered a sound that stood out from the rest, and regular gigs soon got them noticed.
I was asked by my boss, Danny Cordell, to find a group of my own to produce. I opened up the International Times. The first thing I saw was Tyrannosaurus Rex playing at Middle Earth. That evening I went to see them. As I walked down the stairwell, I heard the sound of Tyrannosaurus Rex coming up towards me, and it was a beautiful sound. It was kind of rock psychedelic, but it was two people playing acoustic music. I walked in the room, and I was amazed to see about 200 kids sitting down cross-legged on the floor listening to Mark Bolan and Steve Peregrine Took, who were also sat down on this little platform, and they were singing and playing to the group. The audience was mesmerized. I had never seen anything like this. About a week or two later, I asked Mark and Steve Peregrine Took to come to my flat in Earl's Court, and I had one of the first stereo tape recorders that was for domestic use. I set the mics up, and Steve and Mark just sat on the floor in front of this little mic, and they just played their entire set. I played those demos to my boss just to remind him how good the band was, and then we signed them shortly afterwards.
My friends and I saw them several times in 68, 69. I used to know Mark's playing as sitting cross-legged on the floor with an acoustic guitar and a guy on the conga drums. I was a huge fan. I loved his airy-fairy nonsense. I loved it.
All these songs about elves and things like that, and this bleating Larry the Lamb voice, and Steve's banging congas. It was charming. There would be girls there in sort of hippie-type floaty dresses. May I read your tarot? A guy trying to lay acid or hash on you.
There's a lot of drugs about at the time. And it wasn't difficult to go with Mark's mood, you know. It was easy for us. Pint of cider and a spliff, you know.
Another protector and ally of Mark's moods was the girl who was later to become his wife.
June Child, as she was then, was a secretary for Black Hill Enterprises, who were this up-and-coming hippie underground management company. And Mark was there in the office one day. I think they immediately met and hit it off. She was a little bit older than Mark. She was very, very confident and worldly. She was useful to him as well as, you know, being someone that he could kind of fall in love with and idealize at the same time.
June Child is very, very important to Mark, both as a wife and friend and as someone who was helping him come to terms with the dragon that is the music business, and a lot of mutual respect between the two of them, because Mark would be like a balloon without a string sometimes. He could just whiz away to some sort of place, you know, and come back here, my dear.
He and his wife, June, used to come to my flat and take their weekly bath. They lived in a one-room squat in Notting Hill Gate, and they didn't have a bathtub. They had like a communal toilet out in the hall, and they used to come to my house once a week. They'd have the bath, but before the bath, we'd play guitar all night, we'd drink a bottle of wine, we'd listen to Beach Boys records, and I think that was the best time ever. We were all poor and all very happy.
But Tony was to bring another of his friends along to join evenings at his flat with Mark, June, and Steve.
David Bowie was my friend. We were all hanging out, and there were many nights where David and Mark would come over to my flat, as they were both living with their parents, and they'd come over and we'd jam and all that. So David was putting forward his friend George Underwood as an artist.
There was Mark sitting there with June and David. I remember June and Mark sitting cross-legged, looking at each other for about 10 minutes, not saying a word to each other, which I thought was rather cosmic. Mark softly spoke to me, saying, "Hey, man, you know, would you like to do my cover?" I heard some of the rough mixes of the music. You know, I'm sitting there listening, trying to think, wonder what he wants me to put on the cover. I asked him who he liked, and he said William Blake. That was about all the brief I got, really. Something cosmic, you know.
George came up with these stunning images, and when Mark saw George's work, he thought he was remarkable.
The very first album cover. People ask me, where do you get all the ideas from? Well, here is the answer. It's called the Doré Bible.
And it's Gustave Doré's etchings, engravings. It's the same dramatic sort of lighting and everything. There you are. Look at that one there, see? Ta-da! I thought it was, you know, a really good for the cover. You know. So I nicked a few ideas.
You'll see a little elf in there and all kinds of imagery. And this is like a dream come true because it had all that kind of psychedelic detail in it. And George came up with the goods. And my boss said, this is the most I've ever spent on artwork. You know, I think we had to pay George £75, you know. It was £75 well spent.
A lot of people got stoned and used to just look at the album cover and see things happening in it. People would say to me, hey man, what were you on when you did that? I said, I was on my mum's carpet, actually.
He knew people would get stoned and listen to his records. He said, I'm going to do this little lick. I want you to get this sound. This has to go a little psychedelic for the heads. He had to make sure that that layer was in the production where people could smoke a joint and listen to his records and go, yeah, that's cool, man. That's really cool.
This is the program from 1968 where you have... Available shortly. My people with fair heads come in their hair. It's even got the lyrics. And look, who's that? A young David Bowie in all his mimery makeup.
Mark Bolan and David Bowie had known each other for about 3 years, but from being both ex-mods on the make, they were now both sort of budding underground figures on the make. And Visconti was their enabler then. He was producing both. They were both vying for Tony Visconti to be their lead kind of person. Visconti actually went with Bolan first.
None of them went directly for that rock star thing. David was doing it via theater. He wasn't sure whether he wanted to be a theatrical Anthony Newley type or not. But it was good to hedge his bets. Maybe I'll be a rock star too. You know, he was going through all these different permutations in his mind. And Mark was going through that. Maybe I want to be a movie star, a model. Oh, I'll pick up a guitar and I'll be a folk singer. It was very interesting that both of them had early stabs at being a success or being a star, but they weren't quite sure. So they were following each other very, very closely in that period.
But Tyrannosaurus Rex pipped David Bowie to the post, as Tony's successful home-recorded demo tape meant they went into the recording studio first.
It was the first time I went into the studio and made an album. And Mark was kind of very green in the studio, so was I. In respect to how to record this band, I already knew how to record a rock band or a pop band. But here we had an acoustic guitar and a bongo drum player, and we had to maximize the sound. I'm the first to admit I didn't know anything about that. So I used an engineer that my boss used a lot, a guy called Gerald Shevin, and we had a budget of 4 days in the studio. And let's face it, in 4 days you can't get up to many tricks. So we carefully rehearsed the album in my flat, and we worked out in detail what the overdubs were going to be. And we went in and we did our best. Unfortunately, Gerald was the first of many engineers who didn't really know what to do with the sound. So we were at a loss, and I know Mark and I were always disappointed about the sonic quality of the album. However, the performances were great, and those sessions produced Deborah, which was Mark's first hit single. It was a minor hit, and it got his name about, and certainly we broke some ground with that. And we got a great ally, of course, John Peel, who was one of the DJs who repeatedly played Deborah over and over again.
Jimmy Young suggested on the radio the other day that I was Tyrannosaurus Rex, and if he's listening this evening, he's really going to appreciate this next trick. This one is Deborah.
John Peel fell in love with Tyrannosaurus Rex and would play their records on the radio to the point of annoyance to many listeners, and was very supportive and helped break them.
John Peel was probably Mark's best friend at the time, besides me. We were the only two people who really knew that Mark was going to be enormous and take off, maybe from slightly different angles. John Peel saw Mark as some kind of a hippie guru, mystical, beautiful person who fell from heaven to earth, you know, which was a great way to see Mark. Mark certainly had those qualities. He really believed in Mark, and without John Peel's support, we would have never gotten any airplay whatsoever.
Oh, once or twice a week, Mark comes round to Festive Peel Acres, and we sit there and listen to old Ricky Nelson records, and we listen to Eddie Cochran and Gene Vincent and early Elvis Presley things. Mark going through his second childhood, me through my third or fourth.
We came up with this wacky idea to get Radio One to play Deborah. So we went to Hamley's and bought these little plastic Tyrannosaurus Rex dolls. And we spent all afternoon, Steve, my girlfriend, Mark, and June, we decided to paint them in psychedelic colors. And then we hung these little signs around each dinosaur's neck. It said Deborah, which we misspelt. We put an H on the end. And when Mark saw it, he said, "There's no H," you know, and got very upset about it. But we got some airplay out of that. It did work. It was a wacky scheme, and we sent it to BBC, and they played, some DJs played the record.
Songs were flowing out of Mark so much so that a second album was released in October 1968, with a third album only 7 months later.
Yes, it was love, it's the love we trust in him to move like the wind, just a friend and a party. The elements and oceans congregate on his brow. He moves in style like a raw crocodile. Put him down, 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 down.
Mark was very intuitive. He didn't study music, and he didn't read music, and he didn't actually know the names of chords. He knew the shapes of them, and he knew how they worked, but terrific sense of musicality. Mark and Steve were a true 50-50 partnership. Steve was a remarkable musician. He could play many, many instruments. He played percussion, he could pick up a bass or a guitar. He would also sometimes play some cello parts. And then his backing vocals were great too.
But after 2 years and three albums, all was not well in the group.
I think two things contributed to this split between Mark and Steve Took. One was Steve was a true hippie. He would live in squats. He'd go missing for a few days. He'd turn up with his like big bags under his eyes. He had a drug bust, and some police found some hash on him. Steve being busted was something, you know, it didn't have the chic it had years later, like a, you know, drug bust, doing rehab and things like that. It was really a stigma. It was terrible to have that on your name in those days. And when you were busted, you were a criminal, you know. He looked terrible when he came out of prison. He was a broken man. The second factor is Steve did the unspeakable thing. He said, "I want to do some of my songs." That will always break up a group.
There's only one star in any group that Mark Bolan's ever been in. So Steve got the heave.
Were you and Peregrine Took of one mind when you started
out? Not at all,
that?
No. It was just basically something to do, something we loved doing, and we did it, and we did it for about three albums, but we were fated not to stay together, very obviously.
Mickey Finn was brought in almost immediately after Steve Peregrine Took left. June and Mark held auditions. They put an advert in the Melody Maker, and June phoned me up and said, "We found someone who's perfect. He's so good-looking." And I said, "Well, can he play?" You know, June said, "Well, he's not a great singer, but he looks like Steve in a way. He's got the long hair, but he's better looking." And, you know, quite honestly, I don't even think the fans will notice the changeover, you know, which I thought was hilarious.
Unlike Steve Took, Mickey Finn couldn't really play the bongos very well. But he was a perfect foil for Bolan visually. But the main thing also was that he just did what Mark told him to do.
The music has become much, much more rhythmic because yeah. Mickey is a very different sort of percussionist. He also plays tablas and sort of Indian drums.
Yeah.
But again, as I said, the rhythm section before was always very loose.
Yeah.
Now we're very, very tight. The musically it's much, much tighter rhythm.
Confident about his musical composition and sound, Mark's love of language and his lyrical, mystical imagery led him to yet another creative outlet as a published poet.
You can hear in the early Tyrannosaurus Rex records this non-stop barrage of weirdly constructed words that mainly put together not for reasons of good sense, but because they sounded good together. Mark had encouraged his publishers to put out a book of poetry, The Warlock of Love, which was kind of quite rare for pop performers to have a book of poetry. But he really saw himself as a poet, and he dressed like a poet, he looked like a poet, he spoke like a poet, so he wanted to be a poet.
One thing he did say was like, I want you to read The Lord of the Rings. Read this if you want to know what I'm about. And it wasn't so much about his songwriting or anything like that. He actually lived there. In his mind, that all existed. And he saw himself maybe as possibly a reincarnation of some bard or some wizard that lived in the time when elves walked the earth. It's okay with me.
We're going to have poetry this evening read by Mark Bolan. What are you going to read to begin with, Mark?
I never title them, so it doesn't have a title.
Okay. Untitled piece number one.
There's a crawling sensation, an astral vibration that's sucking me into your sight. I can tell by your hair and the juniper chair and the piratey twist of your mouth.
There's a crawling sensation, an astral vibration that's sucking me into your sight.
The next album, released in March 1970, heralded a new sound for the new duo.
A Beard of Stars was a big turning point. He had enough money, he got his own electric guitar, and he had been studying Hendrix and Clapton. In fact, he went to visit Clapton one weekend. Mark came to me on the Monday and he said, I sat at the feet of the master. You know, he apparently just sat on the floor and he watched Eric Clapton play. So his guitar playing was getting stronger and stronger as a result of all this study. I mean, he was really methodical. He just didn't pick up a guitar and pose with it. He really played guitar.
Mark's A Beard of Stars album actually isn't far away from being on a par with Revolver. It's a masterpiece, a seminal album. And that's when he first played on record an electric guitar. That was his Les Paul going crazy on Elemental Child is something to behold. It's a fantastic record.
Torch girl of the marshes, her kiss is a whip of the moon. Dawn's dance is a dancing to the hum of a sunny young tune. Oh, oh, elemental child. Oh, oh, yeah.
Again, Mark was evolving, adding a bass player Steve Curry to the lineup. And Tyrannosaurus Rex was reinvented as T-Rex.
I've been playing the electric guitar for a while, and I was beginning to feel some sort of liquidness with my mental outlook and the guitar. You know, I wasn't getting enough out of the acoustic guitar anymore. And it was a natural progression eventually just to have it whatever I felt like in my head coming out on the records, which turned out to be Rhino White Swan.
Mark actually changed his songwriting style. It was a very direct, communicative song. It was a simple message. The lyrics are all about a wizard and a magical hat and riding a white swan, full of wonderful Tolkien imagery. But the guitar was straight off an Elvis Presley record. And we released that just like we released the six previous singles. I get a phone call, and we couldn't believe it. She said, your record's number two. That was it. That was our lives changed from that moment.
Mark and Tony together were fantastic. They were brilliant. Because Tony brought things to the table, like his wonderful string arrangements, for example, as well as his sonic abilities. And Mark had the songs and he had the attitude, you know, and he had the band.
Tony, to me, is what every record producer should be. Mm-hmm. Is your main man. Tony spends all his time studying what I want to hear, man.
Okay, I have in front of me the 8-track master of Rider White Swan. This was recorded in the days when that was the maximum amount of tracks we had at our disposal, were 8 tracks on analog tape. What you're going to hear at first is the whole mix of the song. You'll hear the beautiful sound of an analog machine starting up, which has now been transferred to digital, but you can actually hear the pop of the machine starting up. So, here we go.
What's it called, Mark?
Ride a white swan. Call it White Swan for the
minute. White Swan, take one. Roll it.
Ride it all out like you were a bird. Fly it all out like an eagle in a sunbeam. Ride it all out like you were a bird.
Okay, so that much you already know. You've heard the record many, many times. So the first thing we should do is listen to the basic guitar. This was the first guitar that Mark laid down. I put some slapback echo like you would hear on an Elvis record. We recorded the slapback on the same track as the guitar, and you'll hear what I mean by the slapback. So I'll solo the track. You hear a little bit of flutter, getting some character in that guitar. That is a vibe. When you hear that and you play to that, you go, yeah, and make it, it's a rock and roll sound. Don't you wish you had this at home? And when Mark heard that, that's the sound that Mark says, that's the sound I want. And then everything kind of fell into place after that.
Well, I got the sound. I was getting the sound with the tape echo just to make sure it would sound good that
way. Okay, thank you, man. I want that sound, you know?
She's my woman of gold, she's not very old.
To enhance that magic T-Rex studio sound, drummer Bill Legend was the finishing touch to the T-Rex lineup as they got their first number one.
The reaction to Hot Love becoming number one was possibly even greater than Ride a White Swan getting up to number two, not because of the different chart position, but because it was confirmation that we could do it again.
And Hot Love was to stay at number one for a staggering 6 weeks.
We were selling something like 50 to 60,000 singles a day. I mean, people would now love to sell 60,000 singles in all. We knew it. We knew how to make hit records. That was confirmation, and we were loving every minute of it.
He changed from this sort of mystical troubadour and made this transformation into this sort of pop monster, which involved a complete change of music and a completely different sound and a completely different audience, really.
Some Tyrannosaurus Rex fans, when Mark went electric, as if he'd never played an electric guitar in his life before, were sort of disappointed. They felt that Mark sells out. He's now joined the rest of the rock and roll twangers.
I think, to be honest with you, I liked the acoustic Tyrannosaurus Rex more than the electric one because I didn't think Mark was awfully good at it, to be perfectly honest. I mean, I just thought he was better doing strummity, strummity, strum on an acoustic guitar. And when he started doing his kind of cock rock macho posing stuff, it just looked, I thought, a bit silly, to be honest.
I've always been a better electric guitarist than I was an acoustic guitarist anyway. And I just wanted people to know that. Had I not done what I'm doing now, I stuck with Tyrannosaurus Rex, I'd end up like Cat Stevens, which is not what I want to be. I'm not trying to be a cock rock star.
Mark had reinvented himself from the whimsical acoustic sound of Tyrannosaurus Rex with a solid yet small audience to the heights of number one records with a new audience of teenagers, becoming the teenage idol he had always so desired.
I saw Mark Bolan, I think I was about 13 years old. It was the beginning of the 70s and the beginning of what was the beginning of T-Rextasy. I kind of skived off school with a couple of girls, and we got there early so we could wait around the back. And we stood outside the stage door, and Mark arrived in the car, and he kind of swept past me, and his curly hair actually kind of whipped you in the face as he passed. He didn't sign our programmes and posters and things, of course. He was, looked at them disdainfully. And we were crushed, but it was we still didn't diminish him in our eyes. It made him more of a star. It made him more fantastic and untouchable.
Mark Bolan knew how to perform. He loved his audiences, and there was a real rapport, a back and forth with the audience. He loved to be up there, and he loved doing what he did, and he did it really well.
He got down on his knees and he played his guitar with a tambourine, like very Hendrix kind of, to throw him back his head, and he did those kind of phallic guitar movements that he did. And it was just, the sound was just so overwhelming at that time, the electricity of the sound. I remember getting up in the aisle. I was idiot dancing in the aisle and just overwhelmed by the electric guitar of Mark Bolan and T-Rextasy. It was that moment of T-Rextasy.
He was the biggest thing for a while in this country, and he had a particular sound and great lyrics. You know, they're great, great pop songs, I think, you know.
It's been an exciting year, and I think kids for a long time have wanted to really like boogie at concerts. I mean, there hasn't been a band for a long time that's actually gone out and done that. We started out as an underground band, supposedly, or a minority band, and we've become like the biggest media band for like 5 years or something. Which for me is really weird, because many people used to say, you know, Mark, with your funny little voice, man, you know, you're never going to sell any records.
As publicist for the group, it had been B.P. Fallon who had come up with the phrase that the media leapt upon to describe the T-Rex phenomena.
I regard you have to enter the sacred palace, you know, and in order to enter the sacred palace you need the password. And the Beatles had it fantastically with Beatlemania. In one word, it described what was going on. We were in the train one day going to a gig somewhere, and it just came. It looked like typeset on fire. T-Rextasy.
It was an amazing time. I mean, every single newspaper had a picture of Mark Bolan on the cover, on the inside. There were interviews. And now the same DJs who ignored him 2 years earlier were now playing his records non-stop.
It was exactly what Bolan wanted, what he strived to achieve, what he dreamed of since he was young. A magnified version of himself reflected back to him.
He did love being famous. He knew what he wanted, and I think he just went for it. And it was all very instinctive, I think.
To Mark, fame was air. It was oxygen.
Everyone wanted Mark Bolan at that stage. It was, you know, it actually got quite dangerous on the road where you got fans there with scissors actually chasing him, wanting a lock of that iconic hair that he had.
Fame is what Mark felt had always wanted, just like his childhood heroes. And he had finally become rock idol Mark Bolan after carefully watching and learning from others on the way up.
And he always said that he wanted to be a star. So from about 9 or 10, he was self-educated. Even in the music business, he used to pick people's brains and use it later on to help him on.
But Mark's childhood ambitions of being famous meant that the music business was merely a part of the far more important fame game.
I mean, the truth is he didn't take himself and the art form seriously. It was a game he was playing, and he had a game plan, I think, and he mixed with professionals that he listened to. But I'm not sure he took it all at all seriously. It was a vehicle for Mark to appear in public and be a star. That was what mattered to him.
Did you enjoy the sort of Tyrannosaurus Rex period more than the teenage adulation?
Much less. I enjoyed it much less. I always...
wanted to be a teenage idol, I think. Every person wants to be. It's lovely to be worshipped and all that, as long as it's real. I mean, what a guess, 8,000 people come and see you. And what a beautiful thing to show off in front of 8,000 people.
It was great, because it was just people letting their emotions out. And that was needed in rock and roll. It had got too bloody bearded and too bloody boring and too bloody let's think about it. Let's just go for it. Fuck it. Rock and roll.
A T-Rex concert was really wild because those were avid fans. Those girls would have literally, I mean, talk about throwing themselves on a stage and everything. They were pretty wild. But the cool thing about Mark was that he also had a crossover to the guys. Boys liked him because they wanted to be like him. And, of course, girls wanted to sleep with him. So a T-Rex concert was a really good party.
Mark's rock and roll dreams had come true. And just like his childhood heroes, he became a star of the silver screen.
You can see clearly in the Born to Boogie film that the concerts were as unruly as Beatles concerts. People were screaming nonstop. I mean, right through the songs, right through the introductions.
It was very interesting, the changing of the guard, you know, between Beatles and T-Rex. Because there you had all these people in the audience at the Wembley Empire Pool going completely bonkers, having the time of their lives. And there, in between the crash barrier and the stage, was this chap with the beard urging on his camera crew enthusiastically. And no one really noticed him, and that was Ringo. And the Beatles had been the big cheese, and now the big fromage was Mark. But Ringo was helping him put his crown on. And that was a kind of a beautiful moment.
To have a Beatle shooting Mark Bolan was for him like an ultimate accolade.
We play for the kids never saw the Beatles, never saw Jimi Hendrix. They're seeing us as those sort of people, you know, because they never saw, they weren't around them.
Music was never the same for me. Again, after that, I had to get rid of all my old record collection and really just discover Mark Bolan.
You had him jamming in Apple Studios with Elton and Ringo. So, a sense again that he'd really, really made it.
To what do you attribute your success, though, Mark?
I think timing, good luck, playing the right music at the right time, 4 years of groundwork, of getting it together to be at the point it is. I do think that we are good at what we do. We've been really the only real visual band to come out of England that was made music for the kids for 4 years, 5 years.
I think it was Mark who was really responsible for opening the door to people like Bowie as well. He really opened that door to the 70s, and he was that bridge from the 60s to the 70s, from the 60s hippieism and the kind of hippie rock to the pop of the 70s. And Mark kind of made it okay for you to like pop music.
You do dress up when you go on top of the Pops, for example.
No, clothes that I wear on now, I wear normally.
What about the sort of moons and things?
Well, that's...
I mean, isn't that a part of glamorisation for...
Oh, I'm not against glamour. I mean, just that when if I'm doing something like that and there's someone's dad watching, I want to get some reaction from him, you know, whether he thinks I'm just a little queer or a chick or just someone freaked out.
And as his brother remembers, Mark's passion for clothes had started even before his teenage mod pinup days.
One of the earlier books that Mark read was Beau Brummel. And that's where he started getting the ideas of cravats, which weren't in vogue at the time we're talking about. He would design weird jackets and things like that. That's where he got the cloaks from in the early Tyrannosaurus Rex days.
And so fashion was yet another way that Mark was like a human magpie, picking hints up as he worked out his apprenticeship until he was confident enough to create a revolutionary new style of his very own.
Mark was a peacock. completely obsessed with clothes and his look. And by 1971, Chilita Secunda, who was the ex-wife of his manager at the time, came into his life and started to, you know, take him to different clothes shops, gave him a new kind of glam dimension to his wardrobe.
And nothing could have been more glam than introducing Mark to up-and-coming fashion designer Zandra Rhodes.
Mark was definitely a larger-than-life person, accented by being in touch with someone like Chilita, who was definitely an exotic person. She decided to come to me for me to do some of Mark's new imagery. I think that Mark was an early forerunner of the glam rock with the makeup and the way he looked and being styled in women's clothes. These were definitely distinctive and unique. These were one-of-a-kind pieces.
He made it acceptable to be glamorous and to wear ambiguously sexual clothing, and he really fully embraced it.
Mark always dressed interestingly, you know, like the little Anello and Devi girl shoes and stuff like that, and the little blouses and things like that.
This is some of the pieces we got left of Mark's. This is a Zandra Rhodes top that he used to wear on stage.
When I see him performing like that and the fact we put the long strings on it, I can see also the link with the collection that I did based on the North American Indian.
Some of his trousers, and if you look at these, the waistline, that is when he was his thinnest.
Mark Bolan was the epitome of what a rock star should look like. He wore things that were really sort of revolutionary. And of course, everybody copied him.
This bag I've got here, Mark used to use it in his dressing room. Inside, we've got actual files of the glitter that Mark used to put on his face.
The makeup came just for fun, really. And interestingly enough, then you had people like the Stones, you know, suddenly all, you know, wearing eye makeup and stuff like that. And so it went beyond Mark and T-Rex and everything. It actually had a social impact.
Certainly, there's been a change in England in 2 years, and we are part of the change. I mean, guys now can wear makeup, they can shout and scream.
Mark's unique look and style had created glam rock, a look that soon dominated the airwaves and the pop charts.
He was very, very image conscious. He was very good at marketing, regardless of how foolish he may have looked in his feather boas and high-heeled shoes and stuff.
The States soon to do a tour. We're playing very big stadiums and stuff. And I'm going to use chick singers and I just want a bigger sound, you know?
No secret, he was in love with American R&B, and he really wanted to make a record that was respectably funky and, you know, had R&B overtones and all that. And Gloria was the doorway to him. When he saw Gloria and he heard her sing, she was blues incarnate. You know, she was really the real deal.
Gloria Jones' work as a performer, producer, and songwriter at Motown Records is what attracted Mark to her. But to many, it was her 1964 record, Tainted Love, that was most memorable.
I was drawn to Tainted Love, and it was a fantastic song, but I was drawn to it even more by Gloria's fantastic vocals of the track. And she brought into Mark this fantastic soul influence into his music, gave it another dimension, and took it to another level.
Mark had the tunes, he had the talent, you brought your element.
He was creative, artistic. He was before his time.
I think he was still trying to find that new hook, that new angle. I think that Gloria, putting all the girl vocals on and everything, she was making the music slightly more soulful.
When Mark found fame, I think, you know, he was on top of the world and at the top of his game. I think the shine started to come off fairly soon, though. I mean, he started to sort of celebrate with the fruits of all the fame as well. All the hobnobbing with the stars, all the champagne, all the cognac, all the cocaine, which was kind of becoming a staple diet of rock and rollers at that time. That really, I think, was the beginning of the downfall as well. It didn't take too long before that started to bite.
Mark used to say, you know, being in rock and roll and being famous was like riding a big Tyrannosaurus Rex, and you had to be very careful that it didn't turn around and chop your head off.
Mark and I put away, just the two of us, God knows what he got up to with other people, but Mark and I put away what you put away in the mid-70s. By the bottle load and by the gram. It's what we did.
He was losing grip on his beauty, on his innocence. The drug abuse and the alcohol abuse was making him grow old. He had 20 bottles of champagne and a boiled chicken in the fridge. It was sad, you know, it was the beginning of this new period where he was turning into, like, I guess in many ways he was mirroring Elvis's life, you know. Now he was getting ugly.
We sold 60 million records or something last year. I know we did that, so I know that people are into what we're doing. Right? Well, there's a lot of hassles. The pressure of every time you make a record, it's expected to be a number one record. These things, if you think about them, could do you in.
The pressures of constantly staying on top, being in the studio and on the road, had already led to Mark occasionally straying from wife June. But Mark and Gloria was to be rather different.
Now, the few times that Mark left June, he jumped into an affair with another woman. And I was guilty twice of introducing him to women. June, of course, found out. I mean, Mark told her, and she was extremely hurt. And I think the third time it happened, I think it was Gloria.
The relationship started, I can remember, we were in Chicago, and we were sitting in the limousine. And that's when he made this decision that we were going to come together. It was hard because Mark's wife knew, my husband knew, and everyone started to come see that it was going on, you know. So
June was the typical rock, I'm with the band type girl, groupie at heart. So when he met Gloria, it was all about, you know, I've been there, done that. Now let's really talk a musician to musician.
The pair of them were like sort of cosmic twins, really. Rock and roll lunatics, tra-la-la-ing along. It was a joy to see.
They were so close. It was sort of like watching a good Wimbledon match. It was a real good back and forth.
Personally, Mark could not have been happier. But creatively, he was beginning to run out of steam.
He'd peaked early and didn't deal with it properly.
I think he just got sloppy. He wasn't changing his style much, and he was underestimating his audience. He, for those three golden albums, Electric Warrior, The Slider, and Tanks, he had the audience, but Tanks didn't sell as much, and it was slipping. To me, I mean, that was an indication to change the style, because essentially those three albums sounded the same, and it was he himself who let the fans slip through his fingers.
You can't keep going back and... This was what happened to T-Rex. He did keep chucking out the same kind of hot love for three or four years, and it went against him in the end. They turned on him.
You're sticking to a very basic energy rock formula.
I don't accept that's going to come a time. I don't accept that you can play Children of the Revolution, which is a very slow song with 44 string players on it, and play me 20th Century Boy, which is basically just a rock and roll band, and compare them as the two.
But as far as the public is concerned, do you think there's going to come a time when Mark Bolan will have to change?
Mark Bolan is changing, it's just that people aren't really listening. The kids are, they know. That's why they're still buying the records. We're 3 years in now, man. 24 million records.
Can you see that this repetitive riff
is going to change, that you're going to do something totally different. I've just done it in the new album. It's just that, you know, when you hear it, you know what I mean. And then you say, man, why are you doing something so different? You watch.
There was a kind of little bit of a desperation already about Mark by that stage, and I think, you know, his ego did go into hyperdrive at that stage, boosted by drink and drugs.
I was in mental pain during the making of Zinc Alloy. There was no cohesiveness to it. It wasn't exactly adventurous. It was just kind of sloppy recording and all that. This was one of the things that sealed off Fate. He came in after a take, and I said, Mark, would you mind tuning up your guitar? It's a little out of tune. He delivered a tirade of abuse on me. He goes, F you! My guitar isn't out of tune. You're effing deaf, or something like that. And it was because there were people in the room. We had some groupies in the room, some friends. My face turned red. I mean, I was really, like, so hurt by that. So I just swallowed my pride. When he was out in the room with the groupies, I went out into the lobby. I took his guitar and I tuned it. And when he came back, he played it. He knew it was tuned up. Things like that were happening. I said, this is getting too much like Elvis, and I don't want to be part of a posse, and I don't want to be treated like this, especially when I met him when he was this cheruby young kid and we made these great records. I was really, really hurt and disappointed by the way things had happened. So I talked to Mark about drinking, about using cocaine. Fell on deaf ears. I didn't want to sabotage the album. I finished it, wrote him a letter saying I resigned. Due to your abusiveness, the way you speak to people, the way you've treated me, I gave him the reasons. I said I resigned. He never phoned me up. He never answered the letter. And according to Steve Curry, the next time they were together in the studio or a rehearsal, he just said, Tony's not with us anymore. That was it. No explanation than that.
Mark's stage act still showed the performance extravagances he had learned from John's Children, but the pressures had begun to take their toll.
There was a stage when he started to look like a football, you know, because he wasn't very tall and he got bloated, living the good life, I guess.
Sometimes people lose the plot a little bit, you know, which is fine. Nothing wrong in losing the plot. What is important is what happens after that. Do you become Fat Elvis all your life?
Everyone is paranoid. Every number one you get, the next one that follows, you've got to top it, man. Yeah. Or you ain't hot. It never stops. The mania is, it never fucking stops, man. How many number one records do you get to be secure when there's no security?
After a lackluster and lethargic U.S. tour at the end of 1974, percussionist Mickey Finn left T-Rex. And with his fans deserting him, Mark was advised by his accountants to spend time out of the U.K. as a tax exile.
Mid-70s, Bolan was out in Monte Carlo, hiding from the tax man, hiding from the audience that kind of didn't want him anymore either. Becoming this kind of recluse in a, you know, Marlene Dietrich, Garbo, Rolling Stones, tax exile kind of thing, hoping perhaps that, you know, it'll create a bigger market when he came back home.
Monte Carlo was a place where he was able to reflect. He did a lot of reading. And he started practicing his licks. He was very hurt that he was not able to stay in the country. That's another reason that he always felt that he lost his fans, too.
But a call from the UK gave Mark the chance to appeal to a whole new generation of fans with an opportunity to really go to town with his glam rock image.
Well, Mark, by this stage, I mean, he always valued an audience. So when the offer came in from Mike Mansfield to appear on Supersonic, which was a children's show in the mid-70s, despised by rock and progressive rock fans and heavy rock fans, but, you know, for him, that was a place where he could actually find a home again.
What Supersonic offered them was the chance at least to move around a studio and to sort of take part in this adventure, this sort of rock and roll musical extravaganza, where they were given the chance to do whatever they want to do.
And roll Supersonic, stand by Slick, stand by Mark Bolan, stand by John Miles.
We were always reaching out beyond our fingertips to see what was out there visually to enliven the show.
Mark was always a kind of a no person. He didn't relish going over the past, I don't think. He was always looking forward.
watching things like the Supersonic shows, which were, you know, a great, fantastic marriage of Mike Mansfield and Mark Bolan. It's just fantastic. And you see, you watch those shows now, and he's so kind of overawed with being Mark that he kind of comes out of the rocket ship, and he forgets to lip-sync to the words, and he kind of seems a bit disorientated. He almost has this kind of like 1920s kind of like silent film star kind of makeup. But all those things were fantastic. They're what made you like him even more.
One moment I remember was when he said to me, "What are you going to do to me next, Mike?" And I said, "Well, we're going to build a swan for you in the studio." And he said, "Well, what are you going to do with it?" And I said, "Well, you're going to ride this swan around the studio." And we filled the studio with dry ice. And he came in and he saw this white swan and he just simply couldn't believe it. Catch your head start. Place it on your forehead, see if it spells, and baby, there you go. Take a black cat and sit it on your shoulder, and in the morning you'll hug me now.
There were those around Mark who encouraged the super posy performance.
His presentation was very often unnecessarily over the top. You know, it was just like as many feathers as possible or whatever the fuck, you know, rather than any finesse.
I did try to talk him out of it and try to ask him to suggest him rather that he should temper his performance a little more with the slightly more serious Mark, you know.
If that was the only film left of Mark Bolan, I would be very disappointed.
Mark was sort of pop theatre, and he was made for Supersonic. Supersonic was made for him.
With his appetite back for performing, Mark decided it was time to do something about his other appetites.
We went to the health farm, and Mark says, "These people are going to kill me in here," you know, because, I mean, they were doing the hose, and they told him that his heart was of a 70-year-old man. And that's when he realized, oh, I have worked 10 years. I haven't taken one vacation. I have done nothing but create, write, record, and not live. And so that was the first beginning of, I've got to become healthy. Then the baby, I must live for my child.
You've just become a father. How do you feel? Do you feel different?
I'm still waiting to feel different. I'm still waiting to grow up, you know. And I haven't done that yet. No, it's lovely. I helped deliver the baby as well. Mm. It's called Roland Bolan. Roland Seymour Bolan. And he weighed about 6'6" when he came out. And it was really cute, because I mean, it looks like me. So it was really... And it's an amazing thing.
Yeah,
I'm hoping it's going to stabilise me somehow.
When Roland was born, he gave up booze. And he lost all of the weight. And he says, you know what, all that money we spent at the health clinic, all I had to do was just stop making those martinis. And I mean, but that was more.
The birth of baby Roland Bolan gave Mark a new enthusiasm for his music. With the release of the 1976 Futuristic Dragon album and Dandy and the Underworld the following year.
Had a new T-Rex on board, basically made up of very competent session musicians, a couple of whom he poached from David Bowie, which he was particularly pleased about. So it was a cleaner, actually more orthodox T-Rex sound.
Suddenly we had this real red-hot, groovy little band that was quick and simple. Rock and roll it, even stroke it, baby, rock
and roll it, yeah. When he put the band together with Herbie Miller, Dino on organ, he was very comfortable with that sound. And what he liked was that they liked music. They liked playing music. They liked creating and finding new sounds.
T-Rex is the best band I've ever worked with. Sometimes, after he got the groove and showed us what to do, he'd go in the box as the producer and sit and listen. He'd press the button and say, "Hole in one." That meant, "Keep that take." And the engineer might say, "Or shall we do a safety master?" He'd say, "I'm the master." Yeah, he's all right.
But the choice of the punk group The Damned as support band on the Dandy in the Underworld tour raised a few eyebrows.
The Damned does seem an odd choice for Bolan to tour with, but at the time, like all the old-timers, he was shocked by punk at first and didn't know what to do with it. Then he realised that he could nail his mask to it.
Everyone said, hey, Mark, you're crazy to do these places. We played them, we sold them all out. The Rainbow was sold out real quick, everywhere real quick. And they said, hey, they're a punk audience. My audience. I mean, it was three quarters Mark Bolan audience, a quarter Damned, and it ended up 100% a rock and roll fan club.
I wouldn't think for a second that Mark was a big Damned fan, personally. I would think that it was very convenient for him to take them on a tour to put bums on seats. He was as cynical as any marketing man is. And I say it as his mate. I would say it to him. I used to joke to him about it. I'd say, well, you know, you're cashing in there, boy. And, yeah, I know, but put bums on the seats, wouldn't it?
But it was also the punk attitude that appealed to Mark.
The cat had punkness in him, and he'd always had that sort of shoulders thing, you know, who you're fucking with.
Well, he kind of sneered at the world, and he kind of sneered at his kind of curled lip. And I think the people who came up in punk kind of recognised that, and they felt that affinity. He just was a natural kind of predecessor of the whole punk movement, I felt.
He really got behind it, and of course it allowed him to say, I'm the godfather of punk. You know, it allowed him to restyle himself, and he'd been doing that all the way through his career. Mark the mod, Mark the Dylan Beatnik, Mark the hippie, Mark the glam rock star, Mark the interstellar soul guy, Mark the husband, and then suddenly Mark the godfather of punk.
When the tour was finished, Mark was offered his own TV series, on which he gave many new bands their first taste to television, although he did introduce it in his own inimitable way.
This is a new group called Generation X. They have a lead singer called Billy Idol, who's supposed to be as pretty as me. We'll see now. Generation X.
One, two, three.
I want to tell you that what you have to do when you get a new wave band on the set is funk them up. You got to go be outrageous. Come on, rip your knickers off. Do whatever you're going to do. If you've got it, show it.
An old friend of Mark's in television, Muriel Young, actually gave Mark the Granada TV show, just called Mark, perfect title for it. Again, it was the children's straight back from school TV slot, but Mark would take any slot that was kind of going. But, you know, for him, that was a place where he could actually find a home again. The other interesting thing about that is that Bolan always believed in the power of pop music on children, because that's what inspired him as a young boy. Seeing Elvis, it was an invitation into this strange new world. So it appealed to his vanity. They're going to see me, you know, with my corkscrew locks.
The very last thing that we did with Mark, David Bowie was the special guest on the Mark programme, and we all felt there was a little bit of extra adrenaline flying about just because two greats on the same programme.
Thank you for goodbye and all the boys in the band, David, everybody, all the cats, you know they are. This is a new song.
1, 2, 3, go!
With limited studio time, there was no chance of a second take when Mark fell off the stage. Only a few days after the recording of this last Mark TV show, Gloria returned to England after recording in the USA and went out to celebrate with Mark.
They'd had a night on the town. They'd been to the speakeasy. They'd been for a meal. They were driving home. Behind them was Gloria's brother, Richard. And he went over this humpback bridge in Barnes, only to look ahead of him and not see the Gloria's car continuing on, but actually just the smoke pouring out of it as it had veered off the side and crashed into a tree.
I went to the tree and already people had started putting little mementos of Mark by the tree. There was glass and blood on the road. And I picked some of that up. There was no one else there at this point in time. And then it was just tree and... And then this girl appeared, this gorgeous girl. And I found myself chatting her up. And then, ding, this thing happened, you know, and I could imagine Mark sitting there saying, you fucker, you know, there you are, you're gonna, you know, I died today, and there you're going, and you're looking at the tree, and you're chatting up a bird, you know, and laughing. And then it was all right, you know, then it was all right. And one realized that one had lost the physical continuity of a friend. But it doesn't mean you actually have to lose them, you know. It's very sad. But I like where he is now. He is very helpful to me. He's very kind to me.
There is a touch of T-Rex in most groups. If it's maybe a lick or two, or maybe it's just the spirit, the vitality of T-Rex, to have music that high and that aggressive and that joyful. There's something about Mark and everybody, like he's really left a big legacy behind.
Mark Boland in three words: magic, magnetic, alive.
Talent, generosity, sexy.
A real star.
Rock and roll punk. A bopping imp.
Beautiful. Profound. Spiritual.
He was a beautiful, kind man.
My favourite performer. I mean that. Just because it made me feel good. I could be myself.
Mark was realistic. Mark was clever. But he had a lot of love. He was of love.
I miss him.
Little girl, is it you? Yeah, yeah, yeah.